Everybody to your feet. Everybody to your feet.
Let's see some more. Countdown starting from 10.
Thank you, middle schoolers. Let's see if high schoolers can top it. 5 seconds.
All right, let's count it down. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right, hands up, hands up. All right, we need to get some clapping going. Follow me. All right, Ben. 1, 2, 3. All right, give it up. This is a new one for the people that went to camp. All right, here we go.
Oh, we worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who party the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory.
If you know what, sing along.
Cause there's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord, yeah. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out.
Listen, When I watched the Super Bowl last year, I got undignified in front of the TV when my team didn't do as well as they did, and I yelled and screamed and did a lot of crazy things. Here we are in the house of the Lord, and we have the light of the Lord. I want you to holler like we have the light of the Lord. One, two, three. Oh, that's good. Whoa, I almost tripped. Okay, y'all can be seated. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And I would like to call Aspen Schroeder to come up here. Do you hear that? Aspen Schroeder is on her way.
Aspen, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, I baptize you. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, I baptize you.
Remember that, Aspen?
I do.
That was a sweet, sweet moment, is what that was. You could feel the presence of the Lord so close. And y'all, if you haven't felt the presence of the Lord, you should be jealous. You should be jealous of what she felt and what I felt and the whole team felt that day. I'm going to be very brief because you have a really good testimony to share. With this girl, she's been a part of my story, a part of my life now for probably 10 years. We were in a former church together, and she was one of those that when I came here, she wanted to come here too. And so I've known her for many years, and I've watched your faith journey, and I've watched you grow in Christ, and I've watched your leadership ability. And tonight that you want to take this next step in faith, I couldn't be more proud of a pastor, a leader, and more than that, a friend. And so with that, I'm going to give the mic to Aspen to share her testimony for you. You pay attention because you're going to feel what we felt that day when she went under the water for the Lord. God bless you.
This moment that you have just watched me was my rebaptism. It was a transforming moment for me, not only in my faith, but as me as a person. The thing is, I knew that I wanted to take that step to become rebaptized, but after I took that step, I didn't know what I wanted my next step to be. And that's what I'm here talking to you guys about today, is taking your next steps. The way I took my next steps was I found God in those around me. Because I believe then, and I believe even greater now, that you can easily see God within other people, whether it be through their actions, their words, or their beliefs. And you can see these things in large amounts or just slivers. So as the saying goes by Jim Rohn, you turn into a collective combination of the five people that you choose to surround yourself with the most. But I have more than five amazing people in my life, so some of these are kind of grouped up. The first thing that I decided to do and try to learn was love. Corinthians 13, 4 through 6 says, love is patient, love is kind, it is not jealous, love is not pompous, it is not inflated. It does not seek in its own interest, it is not quick-tempered. It does not brood over injury, it does not rejoice over wrongdoing, but rejoices within the truth. And the person I found the most love in was my best friend, Lauren. I'm gonna cry. Lauren moved to church when she was a freshman here, and she's been my consistent best friend since. Lauren has always been there with me, full of so much love, and she's taught me so many things. And I know all of you can agree that when Lauren walks into a room, you're filled with that instant love that she has. Lauren is always willing to help you. She sits there for hours and just listens to you while you talk. She's honest and tells the truth. But the thing that Lauren does that stands out to me the most is she always tells you that she loves you. Lauren has never closed the car door without saying, "Bye, Aspen, I love you," or hangs up the phone without saying, "I love you." She is honest and kind, like the verse said. And that is one thing that I am so grateful for Lauren for. Is she herself takes God's love and puts it onto other people. Today in our society, people don't use the word love enough because they think it's overused. But I believe that when you love somebody, you should be able to tell them. And that is what Lauren taught me. Because of her, I'm one step closer to loving like God and one step closer to loving like her. But the next thing that I need to learn in addition to love was sympathy and empathy and compassion. Not always through the big actions like people think it should be, but through the small actions that you can do. I learned this through Christian. Christian and I have been dating freshman year to senior year. Christian has taught me to love people in the small actions and to be kind through them. He does the smallest things that most people wouldn't give gratitude towards. He'll fill my water before he leaves at night, or he'll remind me to turn on my alarm so I don't wake up late for school. Another one is Grant. Grant is also one of our close guy friends. Grant taught me that one person's problem isn't bigger than another. He taught me this at church camp. Everybody that's been to church camp knows that Ernie partners you with one person and sends you off, and you guys pray together. You talk as much as you want to each other and open up as much as you can, or you say as little as you want and not share much. Grant opened up first at church camp and prayed, and we talked, and I listened to his problems. But when it was my turn to talk, I felt like my problems weren't big enough to share with him, and they didn't compare to what he had going on. But Grant looked at me, and I still remember this important statement today, and I use it in my life. Grant looked at me and said, "Problems are still problems, no matter how big or small they are. They're still big to you. They're still big to you" is the one thing that always resides in me when I talk to new people. If I don't empathize with them, I think to myself, they're maybe not big to me right now, but they're big to that person in that moment, and that's why they're choosing to share. The next is Mitch. Mitch is also one of our close guy friends in our group. Mitch stands out to me for a reason that I always try to pride myself on. Mitch notices when other people aren't included and he sympathizes with them. He makes sure everybody feels welcome and is having fun. Mitch, week after week, invites people back to church even though they didn't come the last week because he wants them to feel like they should be there and they should be included. Because he knows that everybody matters, and that's something that we should remember too. All three of these guys in our friend group hold such a special thing. And I believe they hold each of these special things because they're taking what God wants to do and projecting it onto other people to teach those around him. Now, technically, I've talked about four people in two groups, but the next trait of God I saw in someone else was joy. When you see joy, you see God. He brings us the most pure form of happiness, which is joy. Joy in Christ. John 15:11 says, "These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and your joy may be full." I learned this from one of my old teammates and one of my good friends, Callie. Callie couldn't be here tonight because she had a loss in her family. Callie is a person I think that most people would agree with is always joyful. She is one of the most amazing godly souls that I have ever met. She's gone on mission trips, cross-training, and served the Lord. But the one thing Callie does that I've learned so much from is she finds the joy in the small things in life. Callie has this digital camera that she brings everywhere with her to upload onto her phone at later times. Callie takes the pictures of the small things because she knows that God's joy is in every little thing. And that is something that we need to learn. Callie is a positive and refreshing soul. And I believe everybody needs to surround themselves with these positive people. Today, in our day and age, there's so many negative people that can come into our lives and drag us down, bring us into drama, and that's something that we don't need. So I think people need to find more friends like Callie, people that make your life joyful again. But now I know how to love others and be joyful and compassionate and sympathy. But there are two big categories that I struggled with greatly. One of them was being comfortable during worship time, and the other was prayer and having that constant connection with God. One thing that I knew that I was connected with, worshiping the Lord, was through music. I learned this at a young age when I was in cross training and went to overnight extreme basketball camp. All the older kids in front of us raise their hands and pray and just sing, but I didn't feel always comfortable doing that. And that is something that I learned to be comfortable with when I came to this church. Psalm 95:1 says, "Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord." Once again, joy, happiness, singing, it is all connected. It is the way you worship. Worship was something that I could pull emotions from, and I knew that I needed to be comfortable with, but I didn't know how. But there was older girls at this church that I learned to look to, being Cora, Bailey, and Emma. Some of them are here today and some of them aren't. They're off at college. But when I looked at those girls, they would praise their hands. They would pray and just sing while they worshiped. They would drop their heads and just listen to the words. And that is something that I always looked up to because I knew I wanted to do that and I could feel it, but I didn't have the confidence to do so. And when I was a sophomore and junior, I looked up to these girls worshiping like that because I wanted to be comfortable, and I learned from them that it was okay to be comfortable with it because all is well in the Lord. And that is one thing that I'm so grateful for these older girls teaching me. But not only was I grateful for these older girls, I'm grateful for this church because I know this church helped them so they could get to that point, and I'm so blessed to have it. But not only am I blessed in this church, there's somebody in this church that has blessed me my whole life since I met him. There's one man that's done this who has completely changed my life to God and the perspective of my life that I take. This man has taught me to love the Lord and look at the Lord in a different way. He has been there with me through the good days and the bad days. I had a really hard time my sophomore year, and I would go to his office after school because I struggled and I didn't know where else to go. And when I lost my first patient at work and I was struggling so badly with the guilt of it, my dad reached out and messaged him because he didn't know what else to do. But this man also taught me to be a Jesus freak. And I'm guessing that gave it away. Ernie has been my youth pastor since I was a sixth grader at Simley Middle School. And he's now still my youth pastor today as I'm a senior in high school at Legacy. But even though Ernie helped me with all of this that I stated, Ernie taught me to foster a relationship with God through prayer. Philippians 4:6, don't be anxious or worried about anything, but in everything, every circumstance, by prayer and petition, continue to make your requests known to God. And this is what Ernie taught me to do. Through him, I learned that prayer doesn't have to be this large, extravagant sentence of events. I didn't have to sit down and make it so formal. But prayer could be a constant conversation throughout the day. And when I learned to have this constant conversation throughout the day, this is when I saw the biggest shift in my life. When I was in constant conversation with God all day long, I learned to hear his voice and I learned to tune into it. I learned to feel his presence, and feeling this presence constantly made me want to open up my Bible app and read it. It made me want to understand his words. It made me want to shift myself. And it even led to me and my friends having a small Bible group, but that just wasn't because of me. It's because of what he was doing to my friends. So when I stand here today to tell you that you can see others in God, it is so important. And it's also so important who you choose to surround yourself with. You don't want to choose to surround yourself with ungodly people. That's not going to lift you the way you want it to be. When you choose to surround yourself with godly people, you learn so much, as I have learned, to love like God. Show empathy. Be joyful in God's love in every little thing. Love and worship like God. Pray to God and keep a constant, good, healthy relationship with him, because a relationship with God needs work too. And it's because of these godly people today who have taught me this that I can now stand up here and confirm my faith in front of the congregation. And the biggest thing that I taught myself through this is Psalm 46:5. God is within her, she will not fail. And I have not failed yet. Thank you.
Awesome.
That was really good.
Thanks.
I probably shouldn't preach now. Don't get too excited. What do they say in Princess Bride? Get used to disappointment. Okay. Aspen is confirming her faith. Paul wrote to the Roman church, and he said, if you believe in your heart and confess publicly with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you will be saved. Notice that it's a two-part thing, believing and then confessing, okay, to say that publicly, and Aspen's doing that today. Confirmations, saying yes to that relationship God started in our baptism, is a big deal here at Inspire. So with that, you know what to do. You know the drill, Aspen. And I'm going to ask everybody who would like to come on up and lay hands on Aspen. Come forward. Come on, friends, family, leaders, teachers, whoever wants to. If you're visiting today, you probably noticed we're not the most formal church in the world. And that's okay. That's a lot of people. Aspen, you have made a public profession of your faith. Do you intend to continue in the covenant that God made with you in holy baptism, to live among God's faithful people, to hear his word and share in his supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through your words and through your deeds, to serve all people, following the example of our Lord Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth until the day and beyond the day that our Lord Jesus returns? If so, Aspen, answer, I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
Okay. Actually, I have to get down and do this. What we're praying now is what's called the prayer of chrismation. It's from the Greek word charis, which means gifts. The Spirit is now, we're praying that the Spirit would fill Aspen with the gifts that God has intended for her, give her assurance of her salvation and her calling. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Aspen the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm her faith. Guide her in life. Empower her in her serving. Give her patience in suffering. And bring her to everlasting life. Amen. Amen. At this time now, Aspen is going to go over to the baptismal font, and she's going to complete the circle, because when we baptize children, what we do is we dip our fingers in the water and make the sign of the cross on those little babies, or slightly older ones, and Aspen's going to do the same. Now, hold on, Aspen, because I have to tell him something. Oh. When she does this, and I say congratulations, we make a big deal of it here, okay? So I expect you to whoop it up, because it is a big deal. Here's why. The angels in heaven are whooping it up even louder, so let's join them. Aspen Schroeder. Aspen Schroeder, follower of Jesus Christ. Let's give it up for her.
Congratulations. Thank you.
That was totally awesome. Last week we talked about the story of Scripture and how it starts off in chaos, but that God then, through his spoken word and his power, brings order out of that chaos, brings light into the darkness, how he fills emptiness with life. But what God does in his power, he also has to allow in his love. And here's where I'm going with this. We push away from God. We push away from God. God gives us a choice. Adam and Eve are in this amazing garden, and it's quite large, I'm guessing, just really big, expansive, and they have a calling to tend to it and to reach, help it reach its potential. They have relationship with each other, Adam and Eve, and with God. And God says, look, I give you all of these trees, and you can eat of all of this fruit. Just don't eat of this one tree. One tree. And he gives Adam and Eve the choice to say yes or no. Why does God do that? Why wouldn't have God just not given them a choice and avoid all this heartache and mess? Because God loved. And he desired to be in a relationship where love was a two-way street. You can't make somebody love you. Anybody notice that? You can't do it. It has to be freely given in both directions. But the only way that can happen is if the other person has a choice, right? Amen? And so God takes these two amazing people that he created so intimately and said, very good, and he gives them a choice. Eat of all of this, and I've given you all this, just don't eat this. But then it changes, right? There's a serpent who plays a role in this. We understand him to be the devil. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, did God really say You must not eat from any tree in the garden. Notice that the very first thing that the devil, that Satan does, is he sows into us doubt. And he sows into us mistrust. What is the devil really saying to Eve? You can't trust God. Did he really say that? The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say, you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die." The serpent tempts Eve with desire and power by sowing into her the thought that maybe God's holding out on them. If he gives us all this other stuff, why wouldn't he give us this last thing? And what's really interesting is he goes on then and he basically says, if you eat of this, God doesn't want you to eat from that tree, because if you do that, you're going to be like him. You're going to be like God. And you know what? We've been trying to be our own gods ever since. And I'm guessing every single one of us in this room has done that. We have thought or we have said, yeah, God, I know you say this. I know you say to do this, or I know you say not to do this, but I don't think so. I'm going to take a hard pass on that commandment, God. Anybody ever do that? Yeah? Darn right we have. And so the devil tempts Eve with power. You can be like God. But what he doesn't do is he doesn't tell her, yeah, you'll know good and evil, but he doesn't tell her, but you'll have no ability to control it. You'll know it, but you won't have the ability to handle it. One of my favorite movies when I was a young parent, and I'm sure that my boys must have watched this movie 300 times, because, you know, little kids watch the same movie over and over and over and over again, was Aladdin. The original animated version where Robin Williams was the genie, and towards the end there's this scene where things are looking pretty bad, and the girl is caught in this, she's drowning in a sand hourglass, and the evil guy in the movie, Jafar, who is just, he's a sorcerer and he's just power hungry. It looks like he's going to win. But then Aladdin, instead of trying to overpower Jafar, understands something about Jafar and his insatiable hunger for power, and he uses it. Watch.
Without the genie, boy, you're nothing.
The genie has more power than you'll ever have.
What?
He gave you your power. He could take it away.
Al, what are you doing? Why are you bringing me into this?
Face it, Jafar. You're still just second best.
You're right. His power does exceed my own. Not for long.
The boy is crazy. He's a little punch drunk. One too many hits with a snake.
Slave! I make my third wish. I wish to be an all-powerful genie!
All right. Your wish is my command.
Way to go, Al.
The absolute power!
What have you done?
Trust me!
The universe is mine to command, to control!
Not so fast, Jafar! Aren't you forgetting something? You wanted to be a genie? You got it!
What?
Everything that goes with it!
No! No!
Phenomenal cosmic powers!
Come on, you're the genie! I love
you! Itty-bitty living space. Hell, you little genius, you.
Oh. phenomenal cosmic power, itty bitty living space. Eve reached for phenomenal cosmic power, and the result was she became enslaved. Itty bitty living space. Then the eyes of both of them were opened after they had eaten, right? Adam and Eve. And they realized they were naked. And so they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. And then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden. Now remember, up to this point, they walked with God every day. They loved God. They were in this great relationship with God. They loved him and he loved them. But they sinned. And the natural thing we tend to do when we sin is we push away, don't we? We push away from the people who love us most. We push away from the things and the people we need most, usually because we're afraid of the consequences, but I would also suggest because we're ashamed. How many of you have ever done something wrong and then you kind of hid? You pushed away from somebody because you were ashamed of the fact that you had let them down. Let me clue you in on a little secret that we pastors have. We kind of know. When we see people coming to church, and then all of a sudden, and it doesn't matter if you're young or older, and all of a sudden you drop off the map, we know something's wrong. And it's probably the most nasty part of sin. It isn't just that we do something wrong, it's that we believe a lie. And that lie says, don't turn to God, run away from him. Don't turn to the people who love you and will help you through this. Run away from them. And so the lie says, don't turn to the very things and people you need most. When we sin, we need forgiveness and we need grace and we need love. And maybe we need discipline too, but we need all of it together. All of it. And we push away. This isn't just true. It didn't just happen. It happens all the time, doesn't it? Adults, give me an amen if you've ever pushed away from God. Ooh. Notice nobody did that with a lot of pride. Nobody went, amen! No. It's a somber and sobering thing. It really is. And so they heard the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God, the one person they needed the most in that moment. And they hid. And they pushed away. But the Lord God called to the man, where are you? And he answered, I heard you in the garden. Read the yellow with me. And I was afraid because I was naked. And so I hid. And he said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from? Oh, now this is classic right here. Because not only do we push away from God, when we're caught up in this and we're busted, is it not our human nature, our sinful nature, to blame, right? We feel shame and then we blame. And Adam, oh my goodness, this guy is an expert. He has a PhD in blame because look what he does. The man said, the woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate it. Who does he blame? Oh, no, he doesn't just blame Eve. What's the first part? He says this to God, right? The woman you put here with me? Man, that's cold. Adam is so ashamed and so afraid and is pushing away so hard that not only is he going to throw Eve under the bus, but before he does that, he's throwing God under the bus. It's your fault. You gave me that woman. And she made me do it. Wow. How many of you have ever been thrown under the bus by somebody? How's that feel? Pretty awful, doesn't it? How many of you, come on now, be honest, have ever thrown somebody under the bus? Don't giggle too hard over there. It's circular, isn't it? Yeah. It is. And so, the second chapter of the story of Scripture that we need to be familiar with is that God brings order out of chaos. But then because he loves us, he allows chaos to come back out of order. Because he has to give us a choice. Because the highest goal is love. Two-way street. Let that sink in for a sec. He allows chaos to come back out from order. Because what happens after this? The serpent is cursed. And then he looks at Eve and he says, now you're going to experience severe pain in childbearing. The one thing that was supposed to be the most joyful for you, and it still will be, but it will be very painful. And now your relationship with your husband, God would say, is not going to be of this equal nature that it was supposed to be. You're going to desire him, and he's going to rule over you. In other words, marriage all of a sudden became hard. And then he looks at Adam, and he says, man, all this free food and all these trees, that's over. You can't be here. You have corrupted yourself. You have stained yourself. The ground now, it's going to produce thorns and thistles, and you're going to have to work like you won't believe just to make your own food. And then he looked at them both and he said, and like I told you, now the dust that you came from, you shall now return to. You will die. And then they're banished from the garden. Why would they do that? Why would God do that? Because what, along with the tree of knowledge of good and evil in the garden, was also the tree of, anybody know? The tree of life. The tree of immortality. And God could not have somebody enslaved to sin become immortal. How many of you would like the idea of Adolf Hitler being immortal? Not so good, right? Not so good. And so God allows death for a temporary time. And it's hard. We've had a rough week, haven't we? In the Bismarck Mandan area. We've had a rough week. We've had some tragedy, haven't we? We had a wonderful family die in a plane crash. We had another young person die in an accident at a skate park. And it hurts, and it's confusing and disorienting. And we ask God, why? God's not interested in temporary solutions. We live in a broken world. And not only were Adam and Eve corrupted by the sin, but through them, all of the creation was. Everything. From the ground to the weather, to you name it, everything is askew. And that's the world we live in, and it's painful. But God is not interested in temporary measures. He's only interested in the permanent ones. And he made provision that one day death would no longer hold us, and neither would sin. When he came as the Son, Jesus Christ, and died and paid our penalty. Aspen confessed her faith. Awesome. The truth is, we all need to do that because we are all fallen. We are all descendants of Adam and Eve. Anybody here not a sinner? Yeah, me too. So tonight we take communion. And when we do communion, it's not a time to visit with your friends. Do you hear me, middle schoolers over there? It's not a time to visit with your friends. It's a time to do a little work with God, to say, God, I know I need you. Forgive me of my sin. And then Jesus says, come and take the bread and the wine. This is hard to do with a microphone, but I'll try. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples saying, take and eat. This is my body, broken for you, for you. Eat this in remembrance of me. And after his disciples had eaten, he took the cup of redemption in the Passover meal. And he said, this cup now is the new covenant. In my blood, shed for you and for all people, for what? For the forgiveness of sin. You see, Jesus is doing nothing less than reversing what Adam and Eve started. Drink this in remembrance of me. And now we're going to pray the Lord's Prayer. And when we do so, I want you to think about the words you're actually saying. This is the prayer that Jesus tells us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. If you realize you need God's forgiveness and you want that love of Jesus and you want that relationship, come forward. It's an act of faith. Come forward and take the bread and the wine. Receive forgiveness and a fresh start and hope. Come forward whenever you're ready. We ask that you come down the middle aisle here. And then on this side, go to this side and go back to your seats. And on this side, go to the opposite way to your seats. Come. Jesus awaits.
Jesus. worship with us.
You hold my head, rebreathe.
This is such a bizarre week. From the highs of confirmation, confirming our love for you, of who you are, praising you in our highest moments. And for those of us suffering unimaginable lows. That in all of this, in our highs, our lows, our plateaus, that we can worship you. Such an awesome God. It's in your mighty name that we worship tonight. Amen.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin.
Sing it out.
Lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remained. My orphan heart was given away. My mourning grew quiet, my fear rose. Arrested and my life begins.
Sing, oh, your grace.
Chains, I'm a prisoner, no more. My shame was a ransom, he made the name known. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began.
Oh, your grace.
Yeah. Oh, your grace. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace is so. Washes over me. redeemed. Yes, we're free, free forever.
What a night! Can we give it up for Aspen one more time? Man. Hey, you know, Randy said something that I thought was great. You know, God's done some stuff in Aspen's life, and I think it's so cool that you stood up here and talked about it. But kids, remember, God doesn't call everybody up here to talk about it, but he does tell everybody to tell his story. And so if God's moving in your life, you gotta tell somebody, right? And it might be somebody at your school, it might be someone at your job, it might be somebody in your own house, but you gotta tell somebody. If God's moving in your life, you gotta tell somebody, okay? That's why he's doing it. It's because he wants people to know that he's here and he's real. We're almost done. Kate is gonna join me for the announcements while she's getting up here and getting used to the spotlight, letting her light eyes adjust. Just remember, if you feel like you wanna give, we have these offering boxes outside. You can put some money in there. You can text money into us, which is great, kids. If you do that, your parents just have to pay, so just put it into the text thing, it'll be fine. You can go online and give. But you know, something that we're trying to teach you all are good habits for life. That's why we read scripture during our groups and our classes. That's a good habit for life. That's why we worship here. That's a good habit for your life. And part of worship is giving. So if you're young and broke, that's the perfect time to start this habit because you ain't got nothing to give. So even if you give a little bit, that's a big deal. So we just want to encourage you to do that. Okay, what do we need to tell these kids before we go?
If you are a parent of a third grader, we have our third grade Bible service coming up at the end of October here on October 29th. Go on our website and sign your kiddo up so we know how many third graders to prepare a Bible for, and it's a great service. We highly recommend you attend that.
It is awesome. If you are a string player in like sixth grade or up, we're doing String Sunday this week. You can go online and register. Sometimes there's a QR code that shows up magically on the screen you can scan. It's really fun. You don't have to be the greatest musician in the world, but it's just an opportunity, again, to just kind of show that you're into this thing and it's fun and it's a great way to serve here at Inspire. So if you're a string player and you want to sign for that, be great. We have a men's event coming up, I think, right?
Men's and women's event.
This is for the old people. Young people, earmuffs. Go ahead, put your earmuffs on. Okay, that's fine. Old guys, okay, 21 and over, we got a men's event coming up. You can register for that online. There's a women's event coming up,
too. Which is going to be better than the men's, like I said last week.
Yeah, well, we'll see. We'll see how that goes.
And last thing for high schoolers, if you are in high school, we have our corn maze event that will be coming up.
Corn! Can you ever have too much corn? The answer is no. You can never have too much corn.
We have that coming up on October 20th. Yeah. I believe that is a Friday. I will be sending out more details on that in the coming weeks. So be checking your text messages from me to get all of that information.
Is that it? Did we do it? Peace! We love you! Have a wonderful week!
One, two, three.